Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. It is really a great pleasure and an honor for me to be here with you today and talk about some opportunities to build an advanced platform to support the design of application for a better life of people. Today we are going to see what is ambient intelligence and which are the technologies that we can put together in order to create an environment which is able to look and understand the needs of people. Ambient intelligence is a set of pervasive technologies which can be deployed in the environment to facilitate the system-human interaction and as a consequence to allow the humans to describe their needs, the action that they want to be taken by the system, and on the other side, to have a system monitoring what the humans are doing and recognizing the activities of the humans, the choices, and retrieve from the list of the preferences the most appropriate actions that need to be applied to the environmental monitoring system and control system in order to adjust the environment activities, the environment status to the desired preferences of people. And we want to have these activities done in an autonomous way. We want that the intelligent ambient is able to make these adjustments autonomously. And this can be done in a house, in a larger environment, in a city, wherever we are in the world. So we want that our needs, our preferences, our profile is coming with us all over the world to have a smart environment for smart living. What we need to do in order to achieve this? Well, the environment needs to be able to look at what we are doing, understand our choices, understand our commands, and as a consequence, from all this information, understand our needs and identify the most appropriate solution which are able to address these needs. In particular, the environment needs to be able to learn from the real world, from the real experience, from what is really happening in the world. Need to learn the preferences, need to store the preferences to update our profile in which the system will be able to store needs, preferences, desire in general, so that whenever we are recognized in an environment, the system can actually retrieve this list and automatically adjust the environment to our preferences. And the system needs also to monitor the evolution of the activities, to monitor our changing activities so that the system can update our list of preferences in a dynamic way. How we can do that? Well, we need to consider many technologies which can help. Artificial intelligence, machine learning are essential to learn from the real environment. Pattern recognition, signal image processing are essential to extract the basic information on which artificial intelligence and machine learning can deduce our needs, our preferences, and store all of this information. And data analytics, data mining are essential as well, since they will be able to dig in the huge amount of information that can be collected dynamically while we are in the environment and extract the essential knowledge from what we are doing to update our profile. How we can characterize the profile, how we can understand who is in an environment. Well, what we can do in order to identify individuals is to ask to have a token, as we were used in the past, or to provide the login and password, our credentials, showing something that we know to be uniquely identified. But this is not natural. It's not a natural interaction. The typical approach that humans are using when they are recognizing other individuals is just to look to the face, to look to the person, to look how they behave, to look more carefully when they are nearer to the person, to the face. So basically, what our natural interaction with other people is to use the biometrics. How we can put together all information and how we can put together all technologies to collect the data and to be able to monitor what is happening in the environment, to control the environment, and as a consequence, to force the environment to behave according to the desire of people. Well, we need, of course, appropriate infrastructure to put together all devices collecting the information. And in this perspective, we can use as a model the Internet of Things structure or the cyber physical systems model. But then we need a place to store all information to run the most complex algorithms in order to extract the relevant knowledge describing the needs of people, describing the status of the environment, and the best actions that need to be applied to the environment to create that smart environment that is desirable by people. For this, we need to have a sufficient storage and processing capabilities, and the cloud, fog, edge computing models are actually the modern approach to support these activities. So basically, we are going to have a look to how we can put together these technologies to create smart environment. And here are just some examples. The smart home, for example, where when we enter in the home, we would like to be recognized. The list of our preferences retrieved and air conditioning, light, music, everything in our home can be adjusted properly according to the need of the single individual or the family who is living there. We can also have some safety action for elder people or people with particular problems that may have difficulties in walking. We may want to have some extra monitoring to be sure that everything is fine. For example, if the system will detect some noise, a person falling down, that may be a sign that something critical happened, and we may need to have the doctor or some support arriving and taking care of the possible problem. And the same for other cases. But another area in which the smart environment can be really useful is the smart entertainment. TV set or games can really benefit from an advanced interaction with the users. With the smart TV set, I can choose in a much easier way the TV show that I want to see. And if I am recognized by the system can simplify the choice by presenting the options in the order which has been detected as preferred by that specific user. Smart cars is another option where I can adjust the car behavior, the activities in the car the safety in the car, but also the driving options, the driving style, adjusting the injection and the control of the engine according to the preference of the driver, who is recognized sitting in the car. And more in general, the transportation system or the traffic management. We can also adjust the choice to dig in the various options available for rental services to simplify, especially when there are many, many options, the desired choice. We can use this approach also to create intelligent shops where we can show in the window of the shop some of the items according to the possible preferences of the customer in front of the window. So if we, if we recognize a male, female, young, older person, we can show some of the items so that even though the window is small, it is adjusting to the need of the customer, to the possible interest of the customer. And then the same for information kiosks, augmented reality, to guide us in big museums and exhibitions, especially when we have a limited time, so that automatically the environment can pick for us what we may have shown in the past to be specifically interested in. And the same for the healthcare in hospital and the various services to provide us the most comfortable experience. But we can enlarge our horizon and consider the entire city as it was presented by the previous speaker. What we can do is also to look to the traffic management, to the preferences in the environment to make not only our home or our office more comfortable and safe, but in general, this entire city, the entire area, smarter and more effective to support our life in a more comfortable way and in a safer way. And help in reducing the use of the energy, in reducing the pollution, so that the entire environment in which we live will be much more healthier and safer and more comfortable. But let's have a look how the technologies can help in this perspective. Artificial intelligence, I have mentioned it before, is essential to create the intelligent systems. And typically we can use fuzzy systems, neural networks to extract the knowledge from the data. We can use machine learning, knowledge extraction techniques, ontologies, and many other technologies to analyze the data and extract the knowledge which is essential to understand what is happening in the environment, to understand how to better control the environment itself. And then we can use other techniques like evolutionary computing in order to optimize the various operating parameters so that the system can be adjusted in a much more efficient way. And this will allow us to create smarter, adaptive, evolvable environments. Which are the technological aspects that are essential and how we can use artificial intelligence? We need to acquire signal and images from the environment to understand the status of the environment and as a consequence to be able to properly control it. Artificial intelligence has been shown effective in this perspective, especially for self-calibration, and for error and fault detection in the sensors and in the interaction with the environment. Then we need to process this data coming from the sensors, and typically we need to do some signal preprocessing to reduce the noise that naturally happens to be in the sense, in the data coming from the sensors. But in general, we are not interested in analyzing the entire set of signals, the entire sequence of images. We are interested in picking some characteristics in the signal and the images. We are interested in extracting some features which are representing in a concise way something related to the status of the environment, of what is happening in the environment. For example, we may be interested in the peaks of the signals, in the slope of the signals, or other characteristics in the image. Neural and fuzzy techniques have been shown very effective both for signal preprocessing, for noise reduction, as well as for extracting the features. But how many features we need? Well, if we use too few features, of course, the complexity is low, but also the accuracy of the analysis of our understanding will be low. If we have too many features, the complexity will be higher, but not necessarily we will be able to achieve an increased accuracy. If we have dependency among the features due, for example, to physical laws, well, we know one feature and we know the physical law, we can actually deduce the other feature. So having this other feature will not give us additional knowledge about the status of the environment. It just gives us more complexity in processing. There are many techniques which allow to extract or select the features which are really relevant, both from a statistical point of view and by using artificial intelligence techniques. When we have several data which are connected to the same phenomenon, instead of analyzing each data separately, in many cases, it will be useful actually to merge them, to fuse all information and create the comprehensive view describing the phenomenon in which we are interested in. For example, for managing the comfort in a room, we need to consider together temperature and humidity. So merging these two information will create a comfort measure, which can be used to control through the actuators, the parameters of the air conditioning. And then we can use also virtual sensors whenever we are not able to directly perform a measure. For example, if we are interested in the humidity in the soil, we may deploy some sensors, but sometimes it could not be really feasible in some geographical area, or the sensors can be damaged. So using the reflected light, which can be in specific bandwidth, that can be observed by satellites, drones, balloons. Actually, we can observe the amount of energy coming from the sun in this bandwidth and the one reflected from the soil related to the amount of water present in the soil. There are specific bandwidth associated to the water. And as a consequence, when we observe a significant amount of light reflected in this specific bandwidth, we can deduce the amount of water which is reflecting the solar light in this bandwidth from the soil. So we have created a virtual sensor. Artificial intelligence has been shown very effective in both of these areas. Then, of course, we need to perform classification, clustering, we needed to recognize the patterns from the feature that we have selected. And also in this case, the artificial intelligence has been shown really significant to perform this classification in an efficient way. We need to control the environment. We need to control through the actuator the behavior of the environment. And neural control has been shown effective to capture the desired behavior through examples, or a fuzzy control has been able to capture the definition of a non-crisp quantities, high, low, warm, hot, for example, in a very efficient way to design control systems. Then, if we needed to optimize many parameters in a complex systems, instead of using more conventional approaches based on trial and error, or in some cases on some heuristic approaches, we can adopt an evolutionary computing technique which is able to explore the domain of the solutions in a more extensive way, even in the presence of many, many local minima and maxima. These technologies are able to escape from this minima by jumping in the domain of the solutions. The second technological area that needed to be considered for creating this adaptivity is are the techniques that allow to support identification of people. Biometric identification is exactly in the direction of of identifying a person so that we can assign to the person the needs, the preference, and we can record new preferences, enriching the profile of this individual. Or instead of classifying the specific individual, we may be interested in understanding the group to which this individual belongs, young, old, men, women, in order to apply the characteristics which are common to the class, to the group of individuals. In this case, we do not need to uniquely identify the individual, but we need to recognize the class to whom, the group to whom the individual belongs. And of course, we can refine, update the list of the preferences associated to the class, weighting the preference, the needs of new individuals with the ones of the other individuals that have been detected before. In other cases, we even do not need to understand the group to which an individual belongs, but we need to understand just the actions. This is an advanced human system interaction, since I may be able to give commands to the environment through my gestures. Biometric is a set of techniques which allow to recognize a person or a class of person or the behavior of a person by using physiological or behavioral characteristics. Typical physiological traits are the face, the fingerprint, the iris, and there are also other characteristics which may be a little bit more difficult to be collected and analyzed, may be a little bit less accurate than the one I just mentioned. If we want to understand, not to recognize the individual, but collect some information which can be useful during the interaction, for example, the gesture to be give the comment, or the age, the gender, or even the emotion to capture which are the preferences through the emotions, we can use the behavioral traits, which are much less accurate for individual identification, but allowed to gather information in the direction of the group, identification of the group, or the human system interaction. Nowadays, there are techniques that are more and more developed in the biometric area to better support these technologies in more complex environment. Whenever, for example, the individuals are not really cooperative, or we cannot really control the scenario when we have low light or people who is moving. So we do want to have a less constrained biometric technique, for example, without contact or working at higher distance, or when people is moving, or using just the natural light. In order to support this technology, we need to have a sensor measurement system, signal image processing. We need to be able to merge the data coming from various sources, from various biometries, and then we need to perform the identification through classification and clustering through pattern matching. And another important aspect is that we need to ensure security and privacy of this data, since we do not want that they are stolen and then misused impersonating people. How we can do that? Well, there are many techniques, but also in this case, artificial intelligence has been shown very effective and efficient to support all these actions for more advanced biometrics. But then we need to collect the data. I mentioned at the beginning, we need to move the data where we can process them and where we can store them, where we can extract the knowledge and where we can deduce the preferences, the needs of people from this knowledge about the activities of the individuals and the status of the environment. And we need to have a repository for the data, for the essential data, as well as for the preferences, the needs of people for the biometries, which allow to recognize uniquely the individuals. So we need the infrastructures. In order to support these activities, Internet of Things is nowadays one of the most popular solutions, since this is a non-dedicated, is a shared infrastructure for communication that provide interfaces, protocols, some basic services, some standards, so that the connection of the devices is much simpler, and provide a global connectivity, so that we just need to connect the components, and then we need to configure our structure by picking the data from the sources that we are interested in. So it's a very generic support to our application. The second model for the interconnection is the cyber physical system. In this case, we have typically a dedicated communication and processing infrastructure is specialized typically for monitoring and control systems. So we have the sensor, the data processing and the storage, and the actuators, which allow to manage the environment to which the cyber physical system is applied. And this can be obtained by a fully dedicated architecture or by a virtualized architecture, which is putting together the component in the information and communication structure that we are using, so that these components will remain physically connected to the global internet, but nobody will be allowed to access to them except our application deployed in the virtualized environment, where we can store and process all information. The cloud computing is nowadays the most natural approach to create the appropriate storage and computing infrastructure so that we can store them there, all information coming from the peripherals, and run our application wherever we are in the world. And this allow also to deploy the applications in a very easy way, but allow also to bring our profiles around the world in a very natural way. Of course, according to the type of application we are considering, we may have a significant amount of data which are flowing from the peripheral, from the sensors, the actuators, the various mobile devices that we are connecting to the network toward the cloud infrastructure. And this may be a significant problem when the bandwidth is limited. If we need to run in real time, a limited bandwidth may become a serious problem. So the we can try to address this problem by considering a fog infrastructure in which we have not only the cloud for the storing the final data, the more concise high-level view of the environment, and all algorithms that are analyzing the data at a very high level, as well as the profiles for the users and the groups. But we can use an intermediate infrastructure, the fog infrastructure, some servers which are nearer to the peripherals. And as a consequence, the bandwidth may be limited to the connection to this more localized computing and storage infrastructure. For example, we can have to manage the house or a building, we can have a local server so that we can run the preliminary analysis in that server, reducing as a consequence the amount of data that need to be transferred to the cloud. If the amount is really massive, even this type of intermediate model is not enough. And we may need to consider an extreme model given by the edge computing, where a part of the computation is also the intelligence analysis of the data here performed directly nearby the sensors. We need, of course, to introduce some appropriate local computational capability so that, for example, we can analyze the signal, the images coming from the sensors, and extract only local the relevant features locally without transferring all signals in the fog or even in the cloud. And this may allow really to dramatically reduce the amount of computation. Independently from the type of infrastructure that we have adopted, there are some aspects which are really essential and need to be very carefully taken into account to make the intelligent ambient successful. We need definitely to consider security and privacy, not only for the biometrics, but also for the data coming from the sensors, from the peripheral, since we do not want to disclose publicly information which may be related to the privacy of people. We needed to ensure continuity of the service, and as a consequence, we needed to ensure dependability and resilience of the infrastructure in order to guarantee that even if some components are failing, are not available due to security attacks, we are able to continue to provide the service as much as possible at the nominal level. We needed to consider also interoperability, since we may need to add components, sensors, actuators in a very heterogeneous environment, and we needed to use these various components to run our application. Interoperability, as a consequence, is one of the essential aspects in this heterogeneous distributed environment. Scalability is also important, since we may need to add many components in the infrastructure, and the energy is also essential in order to limit the complexity and the consumption of the system. In summary, ambient intelligence is a platform based on artificial intelligence, which allow to support a smart living for people, which allow to create opportunities for effective, efficient use of adaptivity, really to create a smart environment for smart living. Thank you. If you have any question, I will be really happy to answer.
Audience to carry to home, you know.
Well, the there are two aspects that I believe are very important. First of all, in order to create an effective environment to support more and more smart and safer living for people, we need to bring together many technologies and put them together in a comprehensive environment, in a comprehensive infrastructure. The second message is that the complexity of this type of problems, the complexity of the analysis of the data, requires more and more the use of artificial intelligence, since it is very difficult a priori to create algorithms which are effective if we do not know exactly what is happening in the environment. So I believe that investing in these directions will allow to have many benefits for people.
Thank you. Yeah, for the young researchers, you know, what kind of thing you think, what kind of problem they can tackle? Because according to what you're saying, the many piece stock, like a device of computing, even human, mobile, you know, robot, all these connecting, right? So when they're connecting, but you also need intelligence to control, to understanding. So for young researchers, so what kind of problem they should be take home?
Well, they have many problems that can consider. One area is how we can enhance the artificial intelligence techniques to make them accurate, explainable, in order to understand what is happening, how we can optimize them, how we can have them learning dynamically in real time from the environment. And as a consequence, also the understanding of the complexity, the minimization of the complexity of the structure is important. On the other side, studying efficient, effective way for creating the infrastructure is very important, both with the Internet of Things, cloud computing, cyber physical system, since the flexibility and the adaptability of the infrastructure from the point of view of the assignment of resources, the scheduling of resources and activities in the infrastructure is very, very important, as well as fault tolerance, energy saving. This is more and more important nowadays, since saving energy is really mandatory in order to avoid polluting the environment and creating in turn many problems to our future life.